from Griffith University in Brisbane. He's been a giant in the field of quantum technologies for a long time. So it's a pleasure to hear his new and keen insights on these topics. And I expect the mathematicians in the audience will find this particularly interesting. He's showing something that, well, things that seem natural in the classical domain may not be so natural in the quantum domain.
Thank you, Justin. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here again. So I think I'm talking on a what did I talk about last time? Anyway, something different from what I talked about last time, but possibly with some overlap, but we'll get there. So so this work is the main PhD topic of my student Kenny Lee, who will be finishing this year, hopefully. So none of it's published yet, but we're writing a huge review paper, and of which I'll touch on some of it in this talk. And so it's also done with Michael Hall, who's a senior research fellow in my group in the Center for Quantum Dynamics at Griffith University, as Justin said, which our campus is here in Brisbane in Australia. And it's also part of a sort of Australia-wide Centre for Quantum Computation and Communication Technology. Okay, although I won't be saying anything about quantum computation or communication here, but it's potentially relevant. But really, this is a conceptual talk, as Justin mentioned. Okay. So to begin with, some motivation why am I talking about quantum Markovianity? Who cares? So this is just a little plot to show that some people care about it, and you might even conclude that an increasing number of people care about it. So these are just the papers in the QuantPH archive, which have either the words non-Markovian or non-Markovianity in the title, there seems to be, as I said, an increasing interest, but I don't think that necessarily means that there's an increasing, there's any sort of consensus building in the field, and that's why that's the sort of our motivation in this work, is that people are using this term in a lot of different ways, and I want to try to put some order in it. Okay, but to begin, it makes sense to begin with classical Markovianity. And why we can't just use that and answer the question. And then I'll essentially go on. I'll go on and talk about various perspectives one could take in the quantum field and get to a conclusion. So I won't go through everything I'm going to say here. Okay, so classical Markovianity. Of course, so in the classical case, it really is just mathematics, okay, no physics. And it, of course, all goes back to Markov, who's here. And he's talking about I don't know the exact history of the field, but it's conventional to talk about this in terms of a time series of some variable. But in the classical case, there's really nothing that identifies this as being a time series as opposed to any sort of series. But we'll see that that's different in physics. Okay, but it's conventional to think about this in terms of a time series. So you have some variables, x, at these various times. As I said, this is terribly boring unless it's a stochastic process, in which case it's described by a probability distribution over the values of those variables at all of those times. Okay, so this is a convention for writing that. So this means x1 at time t1, etc., up to xn at time tn, x at time t, given x naught at time t naught, and I think that semicolon there shouldn't really be there. Okay, so that's a completely general description of a classical stochastic process or classical series of variables. The Markov property, as defined by Markov over here, was that this probability distribution, that this probability, if I ask what's the probability distribution for x at time t, given all the past history of it, right back to the beginning, that in fact is equal to its probability for x of t, given only its most recent history. Okay, so this is why it's sometimes also called a memoryless condition, the idea that nothing matters past the most recent thing that has happened, so to speak, okay, in terms of this conditional probability. So a closely related idea in classical probability theory is what's called the Chapman-Kolmogorov condition, so this is came after Markov. And that's the idea that the probability of x, so different is something which doesn't appear in this equation, the probability of x at time t given the initial conditions x naught at t naught, I can get simply by multiplying out each of these conditional probabilities that look like this. So I go from x naught to x1, and then probability from going from x1 to x2, etc., all the way up to x of t. Okay, so this obviously follows from the Markov condition, but it doesn't go the other way around. So the Chapman-Kolmogorov condition can hold, doesn't actually imply that the Markov condition holds. Although they're often treated the same, there's actually there are cases where you can show the Markov condition is strictly stronger. Okay, so that's the classical case. So why can't we just generalize, you know, say, okay, well, I just generalized that to quantum mechanics and there's my answer. So for a couple of reasons. So one, in a mathematical sense, why it doesn't generalize. Well, so first of all, let's just talk about the things that do sort of generalize in an obvious way. If I'm talking about a variable classically, what's the quantum generalization? Well, I just put a hat on it. Again, it becomes an operator. All right, that's fine. Most people generally agree that a probability distribution, well, in fact, this is nothing controversial here at all, actually. Probability distribution for a variable at time t, for that variable at time t, in the quantum case, I can calculate using, so if I think of this as being in the Heisenberg picture, this is now a projector for that variable in the Heisenberg picture at time t. And if I take the trace of that with my initial state rho naught, that generates the probability for x at time t having a particular value. So that's exactly analogous to, well, that is just a quantum expression for a probability, okay? So that's fine. The difficulty comes with, in the Markov condition, we're dealing with joint probabilities, right? So just to go back to, we're talking about beginning with a condition like this and saying, does a condition like this hold? So we're dealing with probability distributions at more than one time, and that doesn't have an obvious quantum analog because these operators at different times may not commute. Okay, so the projectors associated with them at different times don't necessarily commute. And if I do something naive, I can end up with imaginary probabilities and things like this. Of course, I can do things to fix that, but basically it's not straightforward. And so that's one reason that it's not straightforward. Another difference is that because, you know, that's sort of a mathematical reason, a physical reason is that we can't just imagine completely arbitrary probability distributions in the quantum case, or completely arbitrary relations between a variable at different times. Fundamentally, what we believe in quantum mechanics is that there is, between a variable at time t naught and a variable at time t, there is a unitary relation, okay, a reversible relation. So here I'm using a terminology or notation that I'll be using a lot, so I thought I might as well introduce it here. So a curly U here means that this is a super operator, or it's a thing that takes an operator to an operator, and it's using the same letter as U just means that, so there is an operator, a unitary operator associated with that, and so this just means the U and the U dagger on either side like that. Okay, the other thing I've done here to, yeah, was that a question?
Yes, you're not saying that mathematics actually permits to have the quantum analog of the conditional probability. You just say it's not easy to come up with an obvious answer.
That's right, yeah, I don't want to go that far because there are special cases, and Matt, you know, is someone who can talk on this. There are special cases where one can do a lot of manipulations that are actually very similar in the two cases. But I would just say, yeah, that it's not, you certainly can't just generalize the whole theory straight to writing down analogous expressions in the whole situation. So the other thing which I wanted to illustrate with this formula here is why have I introduced this tensor product with something else, and that's because of the idea that, so how do we even get stochastic processes in quantum mechanics? We have to, if there is noise in something, in the system, in an operator, in the quantum case, it has to actually come from some other physical system. Okay, if we fundamentally believe in unitary evolution, then that's where it has to come from. And so this here is the identity operator on E, the environment. Okay, so in the quantum case, having an environment is an essential part. We have to talk about the environment. Well, we have to be prepared that we may have to talk about the environment, because if we believe in unitary evolution, then in general, this is the way we have to think about things, that there has to be some other system which enters into the evolution of the system which I'm interested in. Then that becomes the most general thing. Okay, so that said, So here is then what we get as the most general type of evolution which we can get in the quantum case. Is I'm going to assume, or we are going to assume, that the initial state of the environment is factorized from the initial state of the system. So this is, one can relax this, but it's a very standard assumption to assume that they do factorize, so I'm going to stick with that. And so then I can say that hopefully everyone is familiar with density operators and thing and maps and things like that. Density operators at least. This is essentially Schrodinger's evolution, if you like, but generalized to allow for mixed states. So states that are not pure, but rather convex combinations of pure states. So this is unitary evolution, but acting on states which may not be pure, may not have wave functions. So if I just consider the system itself, in other words, ask what's the state of the system itself, that's given by taking this evolution here, this correlated state between the system and the environment, and tracing over the environment, discarding the environment degrees of freedom. So doing that gives me a linear map on the system, initial system state. So this is always the case. If I start with factorized initial conditions and have unitary evolution, then I can always write the reduced state of the system at any time t by some linear map, in fact, a completely positive trace preserving map acting on the initial state, which we're going to call E. Okay. So for those who don't know, then so what do I mean by completely positive trace preserving map? So trace preserving is a pretty obvious thing, right? And we want trace preserving because these density operators should have trace of one, just as a normalization condition. Just in the same sense that probability distribution should sum to one. So a positive trace preserving map is one such that if my initial state rho s is a valid quantum state, then that map acting on it gives us a valid quantum state. And you might think, what else could you possibly ask for? Well, what else you could possibly ask for is that if my initial system state could perhaps be correlated with some other ancilla, so that's what this A is here, and I just do the map on my system, do the identity map on the ancilla, then as long as this rho SA is a valid state, that I should end up with a valid state here on my combined system. Okay, that's a strictly stronger condition, which is called complete positivity. Okay, but it's guaranteed, as I said. It's not as if we have to put this on as a constraint. It's guaranteed by construction that this map will be a completely positive trace preserving map. And if you're wondering what does that map actually look like, it looks like as I say, it's a super operator, so it takes an operator to an operator. So I put the operator in the middle, and the most general thing I can do is just act on it on either side with operators. And so it turns out that any completely positive map can be written like this. Okay, so basically the operators just come in pairs. M on one side, M dagger on the other side, and they do a sum over them. If it's a trace preserving map, then we have the condition that the sum over these has to equal the identity operator in that form like that. Okay, so that's a mini introduction to quantum dynamics.
So these super operators, they act on unitary transformation?
So they act on any operator.
Well, but my question was, so you're not saying that the script E is necessarily unitary?
It is, that's correct. In general, it will not be unitary. It would not be unitary.
Because of the
environment, that's right. So if I had no environment, then this E would have to be unitary, that's right. Yes. Yep. And so there's no, maybe I should say, so there's no restriction on these M's, for example. These can be completely arbitrary operators, but if I want it to be trace preserving, it does have to obey this condition here. So they don't have to be unitary or anything like that. Yeah. Okay, so what can we say about quantum Markovianity? So the most common philosophy, I think, although this possibly depends on one's perspective, but I think if you look at those quantum pH articles, for example, most of them have this type of philosophy behind them, is that what quantum Markovianity is about is the structure of this one-parameter family, these maps, these completely positive trace-preserving maps. So I call it a one-parameter family because T is that parameter, okay? So this, as I said, this I think is the most common. And the way people look at it is to say that this equation, this map, from time T naught to time T, is analogous to this equation here, okay? Basically the quantum states are analogous to probability distributions. Right, and so the quantum state at time t is like the probability of x at time t, and obviously this is the initial one, and this is just an identity. Okay, this is always true, classically, just as in this is always true in the quantum case. Right, so I talked about in the classical case how we have this Chapman-Kolmogorov condition, which just to remind you says that for any times t2, t1, and t naught, I can split up this propagator, if I want to think of it that way, as into a product of these propagators with summing over the intermediate value there. And so that I can think of this as a sort of matrix multiplication. Okay, if I think of this thing as a matrix with two indices, x0 and x2, then what I've got here is a matrix with indices x0 and x1, and here with x1 and x2, and I'm summing over x1, so that's just matrix multiplication, right? So this looks then very much like the analog of this in the quantum case would be just to say that this evolution here is divisible in the sense that I can write it as a product, okay? So the definition, we say that this map is divisible if for all times, again, there exists some second CPTP map, okay, just like this one here. So maybe I should point out that this thing, so this quantity here is just this quantity here, but evaluated at time t1 rather than at time t2, okay? Whereas this is a different thing, because this starts at time t1 and goes to time t2, okay? So in the same way, what we're doing is introducing and saying there exists some CPTP map from time t1 to t2, right, such that the map from t0 to t2 is the map from t0 to t1, followed by the map from t1 to t2. Okay, and so that's argued that that is the analog of the Chapman-Kolmogorov equation. Yep?
You're not summing over t1 because t1 is fixed.
So t1 is just a time. Yeah, t1 is fixed. But what we're summing over here is the variable x1. So this is why I talked about the notation here, that the comma t2 doesn't mean that t2 is a variable. It just means that this is x2 at time t2. This is x1 at time t1. Yeah.
But I ask because in the next line you say for all times t1 between t0 and t2.
Yes.
So despite that, still you don't sum over t1, right? You just have
no.
Less of time.
That's right. But I could choose any, like, okay, so this is meant to be, I haven't been very rigorous about it, but I'm trying to be general here and just saying that this could be dynamics which is defined on a discrete time, or it could be on a continuous time. So when I say for all, I mean from all times which are in the set of times that you're considering. So if it's a continuum, it means I could pick any two times, and that's right. And I can write down an equation like this. Yeah. That's right, but there's no sum over the times. Yep. It's just if I pick a time, just in exactly the same way here, that if I pick a time, I can divide it up like this way in the Chapman-Kolmogorov equation, and the same thing here in the quantum case. This definition so is standard in the literature, and it actually implies an arbitrary divisibility. In the sense that if I can do this once, well, then all I do is just keep playing the same trick on this starting E here, and then I can, I can write down an equation like this, okay? So basically, any map, or if at any time, I can always break it up arbitrarily into a sequence of CPTP maps. And that's what we mean by divisible map. Pardon me. So, there we have an analog, a quantum classical analog I did warn people that if I didn't get a chance, I could get surprised by my own slide. So I did want to say this about if you do assume the case of a continuum time, then and require that this be divisible, and some other assumptions, roughly that is differentiable, and I couldn't even state precisely what the assumptions have to be, but in any case, you get the idea that if I put some sort of smoothness conditions on it, then what I can prove is that this map actually obeys a differential equation with a generator L, and what was proven, this was in the early to mid-1970s, that generator must have this form here. So this generator itself is obviously a superoperator. That if you think about this equation, that's the way it has to be. And it turns out it splits into a Hamiltonian part. We can think of this as being the reversible part of the evolution and some irreversible parts of the evolution here, which is, we don't really care about exactly what that looks like, but in case you do, that's what it does. So this was, Lindblad was the one who proved this. In the most general situation in which it can be proven. So this is often called the Lindblad equation. That's pretty much all we want to know about it, except to say that, the more common way you see this equation written is as an equation just for the quantum state. If given that the quantum state is just this map acting on the initial quantum state, from the differential equation for that is equivalent to saying writing a differential equation for the quantum state itself. Of this time-dependent Lindblad form, I should say here. So we're allowing for all of these things to be time-dependent, but even though that's not exactly what Lindblad considered, but anyway, that's often what it's called. This is where I was expecting to get to. This question, right, so we have this analog. Can we just say, end of story, divisibility is the quantum analog of classical Markovianity, and the main message of my talk is that it's not that simple. So this is the sort of central diagram in this big paper we're writing, just to show that there are many, many concepts which people consider, which have some relation to Markovianity, and divisibility is just one of them. So divisibility is down here. Probably most of the concepts here are concepts that have previously been considered in the literature. Some of them are ones that we have introduced to sort of fill in some gaps to point out that there are even more things in the hierarchy which are considered. Some of the things are not really concepts of Markovianity, but are closely related to those, and so we're including them in the discussion and explaining where they fit in. As I said, it's complicated. A big feature is this blue dotted region here. So you see that divisibility appears outside that region. And what that region is delineating, or this line is delineating, is the concepts that cannot be formulated, a concept based on a different philosophy, ones that cannot be formulated purely in terms of the map that acts on the initial state to give the state at time t. Okay, so that was my starting point with divisibility, was saying, consider the property of the map, blah, 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 blah. There are all of these concepts that don't fit in with that way of thinking. Okay, so, and I'll talk obviously quite a lot more about them. A few other things about this diagram. So the arrows are logical implications. Arrows with a bar at one end means that one cannot take the implication in the other direction. Obviously arrows with, if it's an arrow at both ends, then obviously one can. And if it's an arrow without a bar, then we know one way, and it's an open question whether one can go the other way. Okay, so there are a lot of open questions still to be answered here, but yeah, we've at least made a start. I think that's more or less it. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about next is an alternate philosophy, which, as I said, is going to be an inside-the-box philosophy. So, in fact, I would call this the more traditional, like the physicist's approach to this. Because there's a long tradition in quantum optics, and before that in NMR and things, in deriving master equations of the form which I just put up there, which talked about some properties of the bath. And so Markovianity was widely regarded as being some property of the bath to which the system was coupled, well, the bath and the coupling. Okay, and the absolute simplest idea. So maybe I should point out, so it's this idea which is sitting up here, which I'm going to talk about, is the so-called factorization approximation. So those who know anything about master equations might have heard of this. And it's the idea that you have a small system sitting inside a huge bath. Okay, you expect the bath to affect the system, but you don't affect, because the system is small and the bath is big, you don't expect the system to affect the bath, or at least not very much. So the factorization approximation is just that the system doesn't affect the bath. Okay, so the system environment or system bath state at time t can be written still in this factorized form, where the bath has evolved in some way unitarily, that's just its own Hamiltonian or whatever that's causing the bath to evolve. And the system is evolved by being affected by the bath, but it hasn't affected the bath. So this, if one makes that assumption, then one can derive, going back here. So you see that if one assumes that, then one can derive everything that flows in this direction downstream. Okay, so that's almost everything. There are a few things that it doesn't imply, but it implies an awful lot of these Markovianity assumptions. So good, that seems like a nice, very physically motivated idea. So why not take it as a definition of Markovianity? Well, I'd say because it's actually in some sense a silly approximation. Okay, this idea, so for a start, well, this can't actually literally be true. You can show that's just an impossible condition to satisfy, except in the trivial case where the system doesn't interact with the environment at all. If I ask, well, but it's just supposed to be an approximation, so when do I get a situation where, you know, in some sense these two things are close together? Well, there might be some very special cases. If you have a very high temperature bath, for example, yeah, probably this is satisfied, but there are all sorts of systems which we think of as being Markovian, such as radiated decay or radioactive decay, for instance, or anything, you know, all of these things where you have a low temperature, like a vacuum bath, effectively, where this is just completely wrong. If you calculate these things, it's not a small number at all. Okay. So I would say it's not something which we should really take seriously as a physical condition. Nevertheless, it is the simplest example. I brought it up because it's a simple example of a condition that can't be stated as a property of this one parameter family of completely positive maps. Okay, so it's just a starting point for this discussion. So this was, I think, what I said before. So it implies all sorts of things, but it's a bit questionable in itself. So what can we consider instead? So I'm going to suggest, let's have a look at this one up here. So this is, I think, an idea that's been around in one form or another, but I don't think it has a good name. So we actually made up the name of past future independence, and I'll try to explain what that means. So we'll say now, to be a bit formal about this, so we're talking about properties of the evolution of the system, but now I don't mean that one parameter family of maps. I mean the evolution defined by the unitary so this is again a one parameter family of unitary maps acting on the system and environment plus the initial environment. That defines dynamics for my system now. Okay, so I'm not restricting to just considering that one parameter map. Okay, so I'm going to say that evolution satisfies past future independence if at any three times t0, t1, t2, or rather I guess t0 is sort of a given, so whatever. So then t is a final time, which is sort of arbitrary. So really I just mean this pair of times t1 and t2. I can factorize the Hilbert space for the environment into what I'll call past, current, and future subsystems. Okay, so a picture like this. Such that if I talk about the past at time t2, that's a combination of the past at time t1 and this current interval between t1 and t2. That's how to read this. And the future, so this is meant to be the future at time t2. So the future at time t1 would equal the current in Hilbert space for the sort of current interval between t1 and t2 combined with the future at time t2. And I'll have a picture which illustrates this on the next slide, so hopefully that'll be make a lot clearer. Secondly, that if I'm talking about the unitary evolution between time t1 and t2, the system only interacts with this bit of the Hilbert space. Okay? It doesn't interact with the past and it doesn't interact with the future. It's only interacting with this current bit of the environment. Okay, so the past bit of the environment might have some evolution, the future might have some evolution, but it's not interacting with the system in this time interval. Okay? And then finally, that the initial environment state considered on these three subsystems, these three Hilbert spaces, has a factorized form. Okay, so there's no correlations between what at time t1 is going to be the past, what at time t2 is going to be the future, and also what is the current in the middle. Okay, so those three conditions we think are a good definition of something related to quantum Markovianity, so we'll talk about, which we call past-future independence. And I want to make the point that if you drop any one of these, then you're left with something which is like trivial and can't really imply anything. So it's not useful in itself. Okay, so here's the picture which sort of explains what's going on. So we can take to answer the question, can we take this seriously? Yes. So the point is that there are lots of physical systems which approximately obey those conditions. Okay, so it's a physically reasonable assumption or approximation to make. And so they're the sort of systems where I can imagine my environment as being some sort of train going past my system. So in the quantum optics language, this is very natural to think, because fields, you can have a system with a one-dimensional field, for example, and it literally, in some sense, goes past the system interacting as it goes. So I have this little train pulling my environment along. At the initial time, everything is in the future. Okay, so this is the Hilbert space for the future at time t0. After I've gone from t0 to t1, well, now I have the Hilbert space for the past at time t1 is this bit which has already gone past the system. I now have this bit in here coming up, which is the current Hilbert space for the environment between time t1 and t2. That's all part of the future still. And it will, so that the future at time t1 includes the future at time t2 and this current bit. Then after time, once I get to time t2, then the current bit has now joined the original past as being part of the past at time t2, and I still just have the future at time t2 going on. Okay, so the idea is that I can make a construction like this for arbitrary times which I choose, it all works. So does that, hopefully that physical picture makes some sort of sense about what those approximations are. And I guess the crucial thing is, yeah, the crucial thing is that initially these carriages have to be in uncorrelated states. So each little bit here of the environment is uncorrelated with the other bits as it comes along. They can have their own evolution within them as they carry along. Things should be happening within the carriages, but there is no mixing between the carriages. Okay, they just come along. The only thing that can happen is that they interact. So I should have pointed out this little station here is meant to be the system, which just sits there and interacts with the train as the train goes past. Okay. I think this is a perfectly reasonable. I talked about in the case of divisibility, which that there was a continuum limit. If I put some smoothness conditions on it, that I can get a continuum limit. Well, exactly the same thing is true of this concept of past-future independence. But what I get with these, when I put these conditions on it, is something called quantum white noise. So this was introduced by the mathematicians Hudson and Parthasarathi in 1984, and independently, just a year later, by the physicist Gardner and Collett. Some of you may have heard of some of those names. They, as you'd expect, the mathematicians did it rather more rigorously, but the idea is essentially the same. In this limit, you end up with unphysical Hamiltonians or unphysical unitaries. They're not bounded below, for example. So you could say that brings the whole thing into question, but really it is just an idealization, okay? If you look over any finite time scales, you can still say that past-future independence can be satisfied arbitrarily well, okay? So I still think it's a perfectly reasonable approximation. And the intuition about what makes it work is a separation of time scales, as is usual in physics, okay? And the separation of time scale is between a Bath correlation time, which is much shorter than the system decoherence time, so the sort of time scale on which anything interesting happens on the system. And the idea is if we have this separation, then I can introduce an intermediate time scale and think of that essentially as being the time scale which defines the carriages on this train, okay? So the Bath correlation time is essentially saying, yeah, that's the time on which I get correlations between little bits of my Bath. So if I wanted to find carriages, I better make those carriages much longer than that Bath correlation time, because I want to essentially say that this carriage is uncorrelated to that carriage, okay? So there will be a little tiny bit of correlation across there, but it can be arbitrarily small. But of course, the carriages can't have to be short compared to the time scale on which the system, anything interesting happens to the system. And if that's the case, then I can use this description. So this is a much cruder picture of this sort of idea of carriages carrying along. Yeah. So in the Gardner-Collett formulation, they talk about an input Bath and an output Bath, but it's the same as this future past idea. Okay, is past-future independence Markovianity, quantum Markovianity? Well, I don't want to claim it is, but I do want to point out that it implies essentially everything, okay? It doesn't imply quantum white noise, because that only applies if I have this continuum limit. And if I have this continuum limit, I should point out, then I also get an implication down here to this time-dependent Lindblad equation, which I was talking about before, okay? But most of the things here don't assume a continuum in time, so that's sort of just a side remark. So ignoring that, essentially this past-future independence does imply everything else in this diagram. Okay, so in that sense, it is the strongest assumption, the strongest notion of quantum Markovianity that we can think of that is reasonable, and so one could very well make an argument on those points that it's the best argument, that definition for quantum Markovianity, but I don't want to be that dogmatic, and also because there are so many other things to explore, okay, so many other concepts to explore, so I don't want to say that that's the end of the story, and in particular one I want to talk about is something which I've had a long interest in. I don't know, what time do we have to finish here? Okay. Oh yeah, that would be better, yeah. is to talk about the relation of these ideas to unravelings. Okay, so that's what we'll get to. But instead I'll talk about something else. Because I've forgotten, because I'm memoryless about my own talk, that's right. So what I wanted to point out before getting to that was an example of something which is implied by past, future independence. Which also might be interested, is probably more interest to physicists than mathematicians, but there's a bunch of things I'm leaving out here. This, in case you're interested, this stands for quantum regression formula, but I'm not going to say anything about that. I'm going to jump down to this example here, CFDD, which you would have no idea what it stands for, but what it stands for is something to do with dynamical decoupling. So that's what DD is for. Okay, so just to briefly explain dynamical decoupling, unless maybe if the audience is not interested in this, then I can just skip over this slide completely. Anybody want to hear about dynamical decoupling? Sorry? You don't know what it is? No, okay, all right, well, all right, okay. So dynamical, I'm sure some people have heard of it. Dynamical decoupling is an idea, it was invented again in NMR in the 1950s, I think, by Otto Hahn. It's a way to undo the effect of noise from the environment. So in the general terms that we're going to define it is that you apply unitary controls to your system alone, so you're not doing anything to the environment, you just do things on your system. Nevertheless, it's a way to get rid of the environmental noise. So how can that possibly work? Well, it works if you have environmental noise which is slow or has a memory, in other words, where there are correlations between the future and past. Okay, so where we don't have this future-past independence. And so here's this nice diagram. So let's say I want, so why we did it, yeah, okay. I'm not sure why I start in this point here, but let's say I want to be in the XY plane of this block sphere. So I rotate down and there I am. Okay, the problem is that there's a magnetic field in my system, and this is an unknown magnetic field. Now, typically in NMR, what you actually have is a sample, like you've actually got a test tube with your molecules in it, and different molecules see different magnetic fields because they're actually in different parts of the test tube. Okay, but you could think of it as a virtual ensemble that you have a single system, and you just don't know where that single atom is in the test tube, so to speak. Okay, and you don't know what magnetic field it's going to see, but the magnetic field is essentially constant over the time that you're doing the experiment. Okay, so what this splitting is showing is the possible things that could happen to this two-level system, this spin, or pseudo-spin, because of this magnetic field or pseudo-magnetic field or whatever it is, basically that it gets spread out. Okay, so if I look at what's happening to the average block vector, that's of course going to be shrinking, because it's getting spread out like this. And if I average up all these little vectors here, I get something which sits inside the block sphere. Okay, so that's bad. How can I fix it? Well, if I do at some point a rotation to the opposite side of the block sphere like this, so rotate around the x-axis, then if the spins which have been rotating in this direction will continue to rotate in that direction, but they're now over on this side, so as they continue to rotate, they will actually go closer back to the axis, okay? And likewise, the ones which have been rotating this way are going to continue to rotate this way, but that actually takes them back, okay? So if the time that I wait from the initial rotation here to this flip is the same, at the end I know that they will all recohere. Right, so by just doing operations on the system alone, I've completely undone the effect of the environmental decoherence. And so generally the way I can think about this is that, I have interspersed between the interactions between the system and the environment, I have these unitaries V1, V2, etc. up to Vn, which I'm just doing on the system. We're going to define or give a criterion for the complete failure of dynamical decoupling is if I can model this thing simply by considering maps on the system alone. So to say that there exists completely positive trace preserving maps on the system alone, such that all I'm doing is saying that there's some system evolution, then I do a unit tree on the system, then there's some other completely positive map on the system, etc., all the way up to the end. So why would I say that this is failure of dynamical decoupling? Well, because if I can model it like this, then essentially if each map here is doing decoherence, I can't be undoing that just by doing unitaries on the system. Okay, so if this causes decoherence, well then doing a unitary on the system just preserves the purity, doesn't do anything like that, and so I can't actually undo anything. And so the whole point is that this spin echo can't be described like that because this is a non-Markovian bath. This is a bath with memory. As I talked about, it's in fact a bath with an infinite memory, so to speak. It's just a constant noise bath. Okay, so what I can prove is that if I have a Markovian in the sense of past, future, independence bath, then that guarantees that dynamical decoupling will completely fail. Okay, so dynamical decoupling only works if I have a non-Markovian bath. So the important point, though, to make is that divisibility does not imply complete failure of dynamical decoupling. Okay, so it could be the case that I can write this map as a product of completely positive maps. That doesn't imply that this expression here, this unit tree, evaluates to the same thing. I shouldn't say unitary. This thing that happens when I intersperse my actual evolution with unitaries. Okay, so I can write explicit counterexamples, right? I can show there are in fact a number of points where it fails to try to go from divisibility to complete failure of dynamical decoupling. There are like at least it looks like there are three points along there where I can point to counterexamples. Of the implication. Okay, so I can't go from divisibility to there. And I can actually split up the reasons that it fails into, a number of stages. So there's a big gap between divisibility and complete failure of dynamical decoupling, whereas naively you might think that, right, if you can divide up your dynamical map, then if you're doing unitaries in between, then you could also do the same thing with that unitary, but you just can't. Okay, that's an example of the subtlety in these concepts. And why, so I think that for the people who work with dynamical decoupling, their intuition about non-Markovianity, and this is why we've included it, is exactly this idea that it only works for non-Markovian dynamics. Okay, and so that fits in with the concept based on past, future independence, doesn't fit in with the concept based on divisibility. That's an example. Okay, right, so this was what I was going to say that I wanted to talk about, another perspective based on unravelings, but I guess I'll have to go fairly fast. So some of you may be familiar with this idea of modeling open quantum systems using what's sometimes called the Monte Carlo wave function method, and that's essentially motivated by the idea that the density operator, because it's sort of d squared in size, where d is the size of the system, that can be quite large if d is large. And so it may be more convenient if we could represent the system by a wave function, that's only of size d. And so if I had a stochastic equation for the wave function such that the ensemble average of the projector from that wave function was equal to the density operator, then one can evaluate expectation values like this using only of order d reals to store the wave function and doing an ensemble average, and there are situations where that might actually be more computationally efficient. Okay, so we're not trying to do rigorously define computational efficiency or anything like that, but just to say that if there is divisibility, then it's very simple to write down a Monte Carlo wave function algorithm. In fact, there are infinitely many that one could write down. So this is an example of the simplest possible evolution of an open quantum system, which is the decay of an excited state atom. So we know that In terms of the density operator, that's the system is just going from the excited state, eventually we'll get to the ground state, and it's just exponentially decaying. Okay, so in terms of simulating that using pure state, a very obvious way to do that is just to think, well, the system will stay in the excited state until at some random point makes a jump to the ground state. Okay? And we can indeed model it that way. That will give a perfectly good pure state description of that system. But there are other ways of doing it as well. I won't go into the details, but there are other ways of having, like, which involve diffusion rather than jumps, in which the system actually undergoes some stochastic evolution on the outside of the block sphere to gradually make its way down from the excited state to the ground state. And so that's just another way another simulation technique, various other simulation techniques for this open quantum system dynamics. Okay, so this is just showing how on average they can reproduce ensemble average decay, but I think I'll skip over that. Okay, so that's all very nice. The divisibility implies this, the existence of these simulation methods. But one can ask, do they actually have a physical meaning? Okay, and I wanted to imply that they did, because as you can see, the pictures here are saying that I can think of let's go back to the original ones, I could think of this as being physically realized by photon counting. I just sit there and wait for the photon to come out of the atom, and when I get a click, that means it has made the transition from the excited state to the ground state. Similarly, one can come up with physical schemes that are associated with these diffusion equations, but they involve using local oscillator, and some of them can get quite complicated. I won't go into the details. All right, so it is known that there are cases where the Monte Carlo wave function simulation methods have a physical meaning. We can give a technical definition of what I mean by that physical meaning in terms of a pure state unraveling. Maybe I won't go through all the details, but essentially it's just the idea that by making measurements on the bath at arbitrarily many times, I can ensure that whenever I make a measurement on the bath, the system is projected into a pure state. And because they can be arbitrarily many, that means that at any time the system can be sort of forced to be always arbitrarily close to a pure state as many times as I want. Okay? And so if that can be done without changing the average evolution, okay, then we say that that is a so-called pure state unraveling of the open quantum system dynamics. That's the general idea. Okay, so we can show that if I have past future independence satisfied, then there will be not only obviously infinitely many Monte Carlo wave function simulation methods, but infinitely many physically realizable ones in the sense of there being pure state unravelings. Okay, they're not just mathematical tools, they have a meaning as pure state unravelings of the quantum system. And the sort of intuition behind this is exactly like the picture which I had before, except that the output bath, instead of just going off somewhere, now goes into a detector, and by measuring that, I can get information about the system, but without affecting its future evolution, because its future is still coming through here. Okay, so it's sort of fairly intuitive that past future independence implies this this thing, but. Again, to make a point, that's this arrow here, is again, divisibility does not imply this. Okay, so divisibility implies that, yeah, there's a Monte Carlo wave function simulation method, but it says nothing about the physical realizability, the physical meaningfulness of those simulation methods. So whereas to actually say that they have a physical meaning, I have to make a very strong assumption, something like past future independence. Okay. Okay, how do we know that divisibility is not sufficient? Well, maybe if people are interested, I can come back, but we have an explicit example we can point to where the evolution is divisible, but there is no unraveling at all. Just one thing we could point out, that to get a pure unraveling, it's not necessary, so past future independence is necessary to say that we have many pure unravelings. If I just say I want a pure unraveling, okay, then it's definitely not necessary to have past future independence. That's a lot stronger than is needed. And to just give a very simple example of that, Well, it's exactly like that example of the random but fixed magnetic field. Okay, if I have, so this is a this is a system Hamiltonian. This is a Bath state, and I start with a Bath, which is initially a mixture of these J eigenstates. Okay, so that's effectively just saying that the system has a random Hamiltonian determined by the Bath. Okay, so if I just make a measurement at the initial time and find out which J eigenstate the Bath is in, okay, then I know which Hamiltonian is acting on the system, and then the system state, the evolution, if it starts off pure, will remain pure at all times in the future. Okay, whereas if I don't make a measurement on the Bath, then it's going to become, it's going to decohere because of this. So this is an example where it's clearly not Markovian in any sense, in any reasonable sense. But there is a pure unraveling, okay? So just to point out that the existence of a pure unraveling doesn't say anything particularly strong about Markovianity. But yeah, so the essential property here is that this is an example where we have no quantum information backflow between the system and the environment. So even though it's Markovian, there's no quantum information going back from the environment to the system, in the sense that I can put an entanglement breaking channel as a map acting on. If you haven't heard of this, then just maybe go to sleep for a few seconds. But those who have heard of entanglement breaking channels, you can act one of those on the environment, and there is a particular entanglement breaking channel which I can act on the environment, which will not cause any change to the evolution of the system in the future. Okay, that's our definition of no quantum information backflow. And yeah, it's the sort of definition which we can generalize in other ways. So it's, again, this idea of no quantum information backflow, I don't think is a good definition of Markovianity. But there are other related things. If instead of having that being an entanglement breaking channel, if I put in something which is stronger, in particular a correlation breaking channel, and in particular one which is, here we have this idea of composability, where that particular correlation breaking channel is just to replace the environment at any point with this unitarily evolved version of its future environment, and to say that that map based on that replaced environment now can fit in here to give me the total map from time t0 to t2 as being that from t0 to t1, and then this with a replaced environment at time t1 to t2. That's what we call composability. That is, I think, some sort of concept of Markovianity. And in fact, I sort of bring it up because it's a way, in a sense, this is really what the factorization, this is, if you want to think about a factorization approximation, this is really the reasonable way to think about it, okay? It's not that the environment at any time is factorized with the system, but it's that I can at any time replace the environment with one that is factorized with the system and which is just this unitarily involved original version, and that will make no difference for the future evolution of the system. Okay, but that's not, yeah. So we invented a term for that called composability. But yeah, I think that's a sort of, that is something which, you know, a lot of physicists might intuitively have this idea about Markovianity, quantum Markovianity, once they realize that the factorization approximation itself makes no sense. So that's why we think it's an interesting thing to think about. So it has some nice properties. So it implies divisibility, which, as I said before, implies that there are infinitely many Monte Carlo wave function simulation methods. It also implies no information backflow of any sort, not just quantum information, but just no information backflow at all. And that is enough actually to imply that there's at least one pure unraveling. So just to put up that picture, so there's composability sitting there. So it implies, as I said, that there exists at least one pure unraveling. But it also implies divisibility, so it implies that there's infinitely many ways that I could do the unraveling as a Monte Carlo wave function. Okay, so I think that's the end of the things that I wanted to cover. So to come back to the original question, what is quantum Markovianity? So the main point is that we can't just take the classical definitions and apply them in the quantum case, that different people and different communities and Different people within the communities have different ideas about what quantum Markovianity means. So we are basically not going to answer the question, okay? We're arguing that it's better to completely avoid the phrase, okay? Not to say quantum Markovianity means this or this is, okay? So rather what we're saying is that we think it's useful to identify the various concepts that people have considered, to give them unambiguous names, okay, and to define them rigorously, to prove rigorously what their relation is. I said to identify holes in these relations where we can fit in new concepts, which we've done, and also to slot in related concepts, which we wouldn't argue to be concepts of Markovianity, but are nevertheless closely related, and to show where they fit in the hierarchy. So that's that. Thank you.
So if you go up to your diagram related to different concepts, if I look at the classical special case, how many of those things?
Yeah. So we thought about that. So there are a lot of concepts which haven't been considered much in the classical case because it's mainly been studied by mathematicians, not physicists. I think once you start thinking about classical Markovianity from a physics point of view, then you can identify a lot more concepts which are analogous to this. But just not doing that and just sticking more or less to things that mathematicians have considered, so this is also a diagram that we're going to put in the paper, it becomes a lot simpler. So classical Markovian, so a lot of things, and so here there are a lot of things which are actually concepts which collapse in the classical case, which are different and distinct. So for example, in the classical case, we know that classical Markovianity is equivalent to what we're calling here a generalized classical regression formula. And the Chapman-Kolmogorov equation is equivalent to decreasing distinguishability in the classical case, where again, in the quantum case, there's actually a difference. On the other hand, but some of the differences remain, and this is a thing that I guess a lot of physicists aren't aware that in the classical case as well, there are, so you can have a regression formula holds for two times, but you can have a stochastic process for which the regression formula holds for two times but does not hold for more than two times, for example. Was there any other example? I don't know, but Oh, yeah, there are. And of course, that there is this distinction, even the classical regression formula holding it two times is not enough. Well, sorry, that's enough to prove that Chapman-Kolmogorov equation holds, but not vice versa. So there is quite a gap even in the classical case, there is this gap between Markovianity and Chapman-Kolmogorov equation, for example, that, yeah, a lot of physicists probably aren't aware of. Which ones go? Yeah, well, I think.
The reason I'm asking that is because I know you don't want us to call anything quantum Markovianity.
Yeah.
If I'm going to call anything quantum Markovianity,
yeah. Yeah, okay. So I would. I don't know if my co-authors agree necessarily, but I would say if you were going to call anything quantum Markovianity, it would be this past future independence concept. Because that's the one that occupies essentially the same space here. So in the classical case, this is actually equivalent to a regression formula. So you could say, well, in the quantum case, why don't I take this as my definition of Markovianity? And maybe you should, and maybe it's possible that this is actually identical to this. We just haven't been able to prove it. So I think either of these two are arguable as good, like for capturing the strongest notion of quantum Markovianity, I think that's where you have to go, yeah.
Very good. Other questions?
I would assume you would say that the distribution of preprints on archive with names of Markovian does not fall strongly non-Markovian, either classical or quantum.
Right. Well, it's not. It's not an exponentially growing curve. So I guess maybe that means it's not. I don't know. it remains to be seen. It remains to be seen what will happen in the future. But I guess it's not strongly stochastic. I think you could say that. It seems to be. That's just Poissonian fluctuations in the number here. I think that would probably be a good model to some simple underlying curve with Poissonian fluctuations. But
those papers cited the previous
ones? Maybe that's a good measure too. I don't know. Yeah.
Well, I have some comments at least.
Yeah.
And some anecdotes just to liven up what you're talking about. The first is that I spent some time in Rochester, and Joe Epperly, who's there, giant in quantum optics in particular, he's thought very deeply about exactly this problem. And in fact, the factorization condition we're talking about, where we're saying the environment is unaffected formally. And he said this is completely physically wrong, and he couldn't resolve this. And this has bugged him for many years. So I'm thinking that I should forward him your paper once it's completely
right.
So he can see this alternate way of understanding that factorization as a replacement of the environment. I think that's a very deep insight. I think he'll be very satisfied with this from a physics point of view.
Okay, yeah.
That's my first anecdote. Second anecdote is that this past future independence condition, I think is great. I think it's physically transparent. I really like it. And it has resonances with what's going on in these continuous measurement circles for the same reasons. Because cavities, for example, that you send fields into have a natural line width of decay. And typically, you only get Markovianity if you look at time bins that are sufficiently long for decay. And so you can write down something that's physically accurate with a discrete time model that becomes Markovian, but it's actually completely unphysical to take the continuum limit.
Yes.
And like you pointed out, when you go to this quantum white noise limit, things become unphysical.
Yes.
Generically speaking.
Yes.
And so I think this past future independence is actually a very physical statement. But actually implies usually discretizing time.
And I think that's right. And mathematicians love continuous time.
Yeah.
And whereas I think most physicists realize that even when they use those models that they only work because, you know, really their detectors have some bandwidth and, yeah,
exactly.
there's really no such thing as that. But, yeah, so we're talking about the anecdote. So, I mean, maybe this would have been a good anecdote too. So I've given this talk in a quantum control conference with a mixed audience of physicists, mathematicians. And the reaction was they're both saying, "What do you mean?" And the mathematician was like, "We know that this is quantum Markovianity." You know, this was answered, you know, in the 1970s. It's quantum white noise. And the physicist's like, "What do you mean? Like, it's divisibility." You know, we know this. You can't be serious, you know. So anyway, yeah, so there really are big divisions.
Yeah. Very big divisions. But this past future independence, I think you can physically justify it. And like you say, it implies everything else.
Yeah.
So this is exactly what we want, I think, as a company.
Okay, so the second question.
yep.
I mean, if I forget about time and position for a minute and just consider n quantum systems.
Yeah, yeah.
Then we clearly have a good explanation of Markovianity for that. So I'm wondering about the connection between the two. So in particular, if you look at your definition of past, future, independence, I weaken the condition on the factorizability of the state to just that they should satisfy, they should saturate strong sub-additivity, past, future, current. So basically, the past state and the future state are conditionally independent given the current state. Would that still give a reasonable notion of what could be happening?
It's a good question. There are people who study Markovianity in that sense of having Hilbert space, just considering a simultaneously existing sequence of quantum systems. But as far as I know, they've only looked at up to three quantum systems and formulating Markovianity in that sense. So I haven't tried to understand that in detail. So I'm not sure that it even... One would have to. Okay, okay. So for N systems. Okay, okay. Yeah. Oh, you want me to put it up? Yeah. Where did it go? Yeah. Sorry, I went too far.
Yeah, so I'm just wondering about the third condition, right? So in the first condition, you say this thing's strictly anti-factorized.
Yeah.
But what if I say, if I've got three systems here, so it's clear, what if I just say the current system, sorry, the past and the future systems have to be conditionally independent given the current system, in the sense of three systems existing at the same time, would that still work?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it seems to me that's a totally different concept of Markovianity, because you're talking about, yeah, you're not talking about a time series anymore. So I just don't know how they.
Time series, because I'm just going to weaken that condition three.
Oh.
And keep everything else as it is. Right?
Okay. So sorry. What do you want to say?
I want to weaken condition three.
I see. I would have thought that if you have correlations between the current and the future, then you won't have a Markovian dynamics. So I don't think that would give you a reasonable definition of Markovianity. Yeah, right. Yeah, okay, so it may be, okay, so maybe in some, that might be, so that's interesting in the sense of thinking about that again, it might be that we can never really satisfy this exactly in a continuum limit, for example, because you put any division, there will always be correlations over the boundaries. But maybe that's a good way to say that. Yeah, if those correlations only exist over the boundaries, for example, and that they can be small in some sense, and maybe that's a good way to, yeah. Yes. 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 Yeah. No, that's very interesting. Yeah, that okay, yeah, so that's worth thinking about. Thanks for that.
Any final questions before we wrap up? No, let's take Howard again.